adjourn. Today is Thursday, July 15th, emergency board meeting. Thank you all for being with us. We're going to do a roll call, starting with Ms. Bale. I know she may not quite be here just yet. She's running a little late, so we're going to start with Ms. Bale. If we don't hear her, Mr. Isley will move to you. Ms. Bale, are you there? Okay, Mr. Isley, will you start the roll call, please?
Yeah, Doug Isley here.
Paula Rakestraw here.
Bob Wyatt here.
Vicki McKinney here.
Kimberly McMichael here.
Brent Hubbs.
Okay, Dr. Shotwell, will you let us know when Ms. Bell gets here?
Yes, ma'am.
Because I won't be able to see it. Thank you. Okay, announcements. The next board meeting will be Monday, August the 10th at 6 p.m. at Central Office downstairs boardroom. And this will be virtual also.
Hey, Madam Chair.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm getting messages that folks can't hear the feed.
Okay.
Needles are up.
Sorry, I'm giving hand signals and tapping at my ear. I can hear fine, but other folks can't.
On Zoom?
They may have to check in with the online audio.
Are you talking about people who are on the Zoom, or are you talking about people who are on the live feed?
They're on the live feed. It's parents texting saying, I can't hear.
6 p.m. at Central Office downstairs. I just got one that said, feed is working.
Good.
All right, we're going to roll on. Is everybody hearing us? I hope so. We're going.
Tell them to check their online players to make sure that the audio is not muted on the online player.
Check your online player to make sure it is not muted.
Yeah, like it's like a little speaker symbol that even if they have their volume up on the outside of the phone, they might need to push it to get it to go.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. We're going to move on to action items number 3. Has Ms. Bell joined us yet?
No, ma'am.
Okay. All right. We have 2 action items. One is the approval of Plan B or C or something thereof, and then we have approval of the Dillard Academy. So let's discuss 8.1, approval of Plan B. We have a recommendation from staff to start school under Governor Cooper's Plan B. I'll just give a quick little history if that's okay. So on Tuesday at 3 o'clock, Governor Cooper made an announcement that he was allowing schools to operate under Plan B. And if you all remember, Plan B was a kind of like a hybrid of 2 days at school and 3 days online learning. And he also stated at that time that school districts could choose to do Plan B, or they could choose to do Plan C. So that's why we felt like this board meeting was necessary for us to come on and decide as a board what we were going to follow, which plan we were going to follow, and how we were going to follow that plan. Since then, we've gotten a ton of questions and comments from the community, from the county, parents, teachers, community members, and we really appreciate your input and your feedback. We've gotten a lot of questions that we don't necessarily have the answer to right off the bat, but we have been forwarding those to the right people, and we're hoping to address a lot of those in this meeting today. So with that said, I'm going to again read what the recommendation from the staff has been, and that is to operate under Plan B, that all schools will start the year operating. However, schools will have flexibility to offer remote learning with full-time virtual instruction for higher-risk students, teachers, and families. The recommendation is that the Board of Education adopt Plan B for Rockingham County Schools effective August 17, 2020, as presented. Board members, I imagine we have some discussion that we want to have prior to this vote. So does anybody have anything to say? Any questions?
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr. Isley.
Ms. Rich?
Mr. Huss, we're going to let Mr. Isley go, and then we'll let you speak, okay?
Okay.
Very briefly, want to thank everybody in the community that has sent messages. I've tried to reply, and I know all the rest of the board members have got quite a few, and I'm actually, my phone blowing up right now as we're in the meeting, and I've got more messages coming in, so I've tried to address as many of those as I could personally, but I just want to thank everybody in the community for getting involved and following through. That's all.
Okay, Mr. Huss. Thank you, Mr. Isley.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I had a few things I've been thinking on and writing down over the past few days, and also want to thank everybody for all the reaching out to me and expressing the concerns. We've got many people high risk to being exposed. We've got grandparents who are picking up children every day, many older and underlying health issues with our teachers and school employees. And something I recently found out that our local family physicians are experiencing a bit of a delay on getting COVID tests back. We're averaging now 7-day turnaround, which is my understanding they went to the hospital, that'd be a day turnaround, but for others, if you have the potential for a child to be tested and they not know if they have it or not for a whole week, it would be my preference to do remote learning for 4 weeks. And where this would be beneficial is it would allow us to see what, as the end of that 4 weeks approached, we could look at other schools and other districts and see how the plan B, or even around the country, how the plan A, how that's affecting what methods they're using to prevent the spread. And we're all praying that, I would be praying if we did that scenario, that by the end of the 4 weeks, everybody's doing wonderful. God bless, let's send our school kids back to school. I've got children at home, my wife's a teacher, so I'm right in the thick of it as well. But so anyway, that's about all I have to say. I'm just, Dr. Shotwell knows I've thanked him every time we counsel for a potential snow day, so safety's always been my biggest concern.
Yes, sir.
With all these issues. None of us ever thought we'd be put in this position, but that would be the scenario I could sleep with. Thank you.
Mr. Huss, are you making that in the form of a motion?
I'm throwing that out as a discussion.
Okay, just checking.
I'd hope everybody would weigh in a little bit.
Right.
And I appreciate every board member's thoughts on this, and whatever we end up going with, I'm sure we as a board will work together to implement whatever is voted on to the very best of our abilities.
So how about some discussion? Mr. Wyatt, did you say you had something?
I do. Dr. Shotwell.
Yes, sir.
I will start with you. Did I see you on TV last night doing a discussion?
Yes, sir.
So, tell me what you said so I will know, because...
Well, I think I was being used kind of like as a an expert witness in a court case, because she just called up and wanted to know the difference between virtual learning, remote learning, what would be the difference between Plan B and Plan C, and then I think she interviewed the Guilford County Superintendent and the Winston-Salem Forsyth Superintendent. So,
okay, I couldn't, when it was all over, I didn't know any more than I did when it started, so it kind of knocked me off, and I said, well, I know Dr. Shotwell said something, and I didn't know whether you were giving information really as to the way we were planning to do it. All right, now, listen, if we do Plan B, are we planning to start from the start? Rents that have so many days of distance learning first, explain to me what we really would be doing.
Well,
if we go with Plan B.
Well, if we went to Plan B, what we would be doing is that the schools would split their children up into two groups, so we could have half the school come into school on Monday and Tuesday, and the other half of the school going to class on Thursday and Friday. Wednesday would be a day for us in the middle of the week to do some deep cleaning before the kids come in, And that's also going to be done on Friday after the kids leave, so that would be ready for them on Monday. Then, if either way, the kids are going to be in person for 2 days, and then the other 3 days, it'll be a remote learning, where the teachers will be able to have a way for the kids that are at home to be able to listen to the lessons that they're teaching the other half of the kids the days that they're not in there. And so that's kind of how that works right there. You know, it's also going to be a little bit flexible too, because like the not all kids may be able to work that schedule out because of family situations, especially at the high school level. They may need to help with the family financial situation. And so they may have to do their work a little bit later at night because they're going to work during the day. But either way, there'll be a scheduled time, just like they were going to school, but on the days that they're not in school and they're having to do something else, there'll be a recording for them if they can't be there for that. So, and where the virtual is the difference, the virtual classes are completely online, and there's the children do not come into school, but they would be taught by our teachers.
Okay. I think that there's systems that are going to do this, and I'm not opposed to any of the methods. What I would like to say really is I do appreciate all of the parents that have emailed us, all of them, and they all have very valid reasons for what they're saying, and I have listened to what they've had to say, and hopefully whatever we decide today is going to be something that they can work out. That's basically what I had. I just wanted to know exactly, you know, how we were looking at Plan B. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
It sounds like maybe you did this last night. I missed it as well. But could you say the difference between virtual versus remote then?
Yes.
Because I think that's a confusing spot for a lot of folks.
Yeah, because, you know, when somebody signs up for a virtual class, they understand that it might be an asynchronous class for part of it, where the lesson is loaded up and then the student works on it when they can get to it. Another part of virtual learning is that it could be asynchronous, where all of them come on for a discussion at the same time and have that live feed with Zoom. You know, we've bought those Zoom licenses for all of our teachers, for the staff, so that, you know, it gives them a little bit of flexibility. Those students that don't have internet connectivity would still be able to, more for the remote learning, because remote learning means that they're going to be, they know they're coming back into the school to meet with the teacher. So if they don't understand something, you know, they know they're coming back into the school, where a student who's taking virtual learning, they would have to reach out to their teacher, and then the teacher would contact them one-on-one to be able to answer their question. You know, remote learning is probably a little bit like we saw in the spring, but it's going to be a whole lot more, I won't say intense, but it's going to be more structured than what we saw in the spring, because if we're going to start the school year off that way, then, you know, the kids need to be on a schedule. The work's going to be graded, because remember, they said whatever the students had on March 13th, that they couldn't do any worse than that. So you had some students who just decided not to do much of the work. So this way, there's going to be grading, there's going to be attendance, and so yeah, we're working through all that, because those are some of the requirements that we have from the state.
So on this plan, on Plan B,
mm-hmm.
will it basically be virtual learning, or will it be the remote?
It's the remote when you're doing Plan
okay.
B.
Okay.
If you're doing Plan C, then that's more of a virtual environment, because you're not coming on campus at all, and everything's going to be online.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Because we wanted to give that virtual option, because we do know that there are our students in our county who still want to be a part of Rockingham County Schools, but they are concerned about their health. And we realize that, and that's why we have over 1,500 students that have signed up for that.
Okay.
So we're, and we're going to use our teachers to teach all those students. Because I know that's another big question that people ask. They thought maybe we were buying some kind of canned program or something like that, but no, it's going to be our teachers.
Ms. Rickstraw, Amanda Bell.
Thank you, Ms. Bell. Welcome to the meeting. We're discussing some options. Mr. Huss laid out an option that he's been toying with, and that is to do 4 weeks, start the school year 4 weeks with online learning. Mr. Huss, if I'm wrong, you step in, and after 4 weeks, decide whether we're going to go to Plan B or straight to Plan C.
Could I elaborate a little bit?
My thought
in that would give an opportunity to. Right now, I feel like if we did with Plan B, I'm fearful that we might be gambling with people's lives. And again, safety is very important to all of us. Mm-hmm. But the benefit of waiting 4 weeks will be, as we approach the end of that 4 weeks, we'd have many, many other school districts that started back with full Plan B, or even in the United States with Plan A, and see how it went there. And hopefully that point would be, hallelujah, it's working great.
Yeah.
That's all about the school.
I agree with you, Mr. Huss.
Okay. This is a concern. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I do agree with Mr. Huss. I think we need to push this thing out a little bit before we try to bring these kids back into the schools. I've heard from administrators, I've heard from teachers, and we can, of course, our first priority would be the children. We think about their safety. That's the most important thing for us. But then there is another entity there, and that's the classroom teachers. We have teachers who have many health issues. It could just be a pregnancy, but these teachers won't be able to come into a classroom, but they can teach remotely. As you all know, finding licensed teachers is a commodity now in our state as well as around the country. I've had one person to say they may have as many as 3 teachers who say they may have to resign from the profession because they do not feel safe in a classroom. It is impossible for us to fill some of these positions, and I'm afraid we will have classrooms with no licensed teachers. I do agree with Mr. Huss, we need to push this thing out, have the remote learning for another 4 weeks or so, and then reevaluate to see where we are. I know Rockingham County does not have the COVID cases as some of the largest districts, but it just frightens me to think that we send kids in harm's way. We cannot, and you know what I thought about, even during the time when schools were closed, there were several times, I don't know how many Dr. Shotwell, but we had to shut down schools, several schools, to be clean because somebody walked into the building who had been exposed to COVID-19. I just wonder how many times we have to close a school because someone walked in who had been exposed to COVID-19. That is disruptive in terms of education for our children. So I hope that we could all, you know, not be pressured by anyone, but to think, you know, I think we're all parents, and hopefully we will make the right decision for our kids. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bell. Dr. Shotwell has something he wants to share.
Yes, ma'am. Madam Chair, board members, I had a great conversation today with all the principals at the different schools. One of the things that we've kind of encountered is that, as you know, until last week, we didn't know which plan was going to occur because we thought we were going to get it on July 1st. And, you know, it's those 2 weeks were kind of crucial for us. And by not having that opportunity to know exactly what plan it was, we were still just kind of guessing at what the 3 of them would look like and how we would implement it. Yeah, now that we know that it was a Plan C with the possibility of doing an option for Option C, speaking with the principals, the district staff, we do feel like that if we just had actually probably 5 weeks, 4 or 5 weeks, either one would be fine, it would give us more time to implement and prepare the schools for those students arriving. Because, you know, just like all the other school districts in the country, they're trying to get their markers for their schools to put down social distancing markers. You know, the mask that we've ordered for our children. Everybody's ordering all these things. And so I could just tell you, representing all of the administrators for Rockingham County Schools, we do believe that Plan B has merit, but we would just like some more time. So it was music to our ears to hear that that was a suggestion from our board today, because that's exactly what they were asking for.
Can I ask a couple of questions?
Sure.
Actually, I have several questions. So if we're having all this discussion right now, but I'm under the understanding that the governor is saying he's making another announcement on August the 10th. Is that correct?
Yes.
So we could come up, I mean, y'all have worked so hard on this plan. And just today, I've had several different people make several different suggestions for what possible plans could be. And in your defense, I've just said they've been working for months on these plans. This isn't something we can just, you know, decide today we're going to do something different. I know somebody made the record that we have kids come in for 4 hours in the morning and then do another group of kids for 4 hours in the afternoon. And while that sounds great in terms of kindergarten through second grader wants to wear a mask for 7 hours a day and not, you know, have to stay in their classrooms and those kinds of things, that sounded great. But I just wonder how much of all of this deliberation is going to be for naught by August the 10th. And should we choose to have a delay and say we're going to be virtual for 4 to 5 weeks, Dr. Shotwell, what does that do for athletics? And please, no, I am not saying athletics is more important than academics, but we've just had such a huge concern for my parents wanting their students to be able to come together. So right now they're able to practice in groups of no more than 25. They're not using locker rooms and they're not using balls because we're still in phase two, right?
And there's no contact. And there's no, so they can't use footballs, tackle dummies, things like that. But they can do conditioning. The athletic association has moved where, you know, the season would technically start from August 1st to September 1st because we're still in phase two. So that doesn't change any of the workouts, those things. It just means it delays the fall sports season starting by another month, because really what we're waiting to hear on the 10th from the governor is, are we staying in phase two or are we going to go to phase three? And if we stay in phase two, then if you all choose to say that we're going to be delayed 4 or 5 weeks, then it really doesn't affect us. Those extracurricular activities like that can still continue. But, you know, if he goes back to phase one, then that's a whole different ball game. And you know, we're going to follow what the High School Athletic Association is giving to us for direction on that. And it's based on phase one, phase two, phase three.
Okay, so there was some other discussion from a different board member earlier. You were talking about the difference between remote learning and virtual learning. So if our students are truly virtual students, their assignments will be accessible online, mm-hmm. and they'll be able to do that at any time during the day. Is that true?
They could, but what we really are wanting the students to do are to really kind of be on a schedule. One for the, because it's really not fair to the student if a teacher is able to put the lesson up at 11:30 at night and another one puts it on there at 6 o'clock in the morning. We're just giving those students that may not have that opportunity. Like, they may be in a place, because if all of us are going to be on virtual for the first, at the beginning of school, again, not everybody's going to have internet connectivity. And so they're going to have to go to different places to get that or go by the school to get packets. So we're all going to be virtual to start the school year off with. So we're really hoping that we're going to do a schedule. That's what we were planning to do. So it gets them in training for the remote learning when we do implement Plan B, so that whenever they're not in school, they're still following that same schedule on the days that they're out of school for remote learning.
What about
then, I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead. You're asking questions. Sorry.
It's okay. So then remote's the same way. It won't be that you're just able to do it at your convenience. When you have math class, you're expected to show up and be able, and the way I'm asking my questions, it sounds like it's directed a little more towards middle and high school students, but when they're supposed to be in math, then that's when they're supposed to be in math. They can't just zip through all of it in an hour and a half, right?
Right, but you also have to remember, some of the elementary school children are not going to be able to have access to the internet during the day, so those lessons will have to be accessible at night when their parents come home from work,
right,
too. So they're going to get it one way or the other. I'm just saying that we really want to try to get the students into that habit of going to school on a regular schedule, if we can do that.
Okay, Paula, I have three more questions for Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
So can somebody, these aren't in any particular order, but can somebody specifically speak to teachers who are in the high-risk category? I know I spoke to somebody this afternoon, and she's in the high-risk category, her child's in the high-risk category, her parents are in the high-risk category, and her nephew, who has been in school with my kid until they got a little older, is in a high-risk category. So I know that we talked about the family help. I'm sorry, I don't remember what that thing was, but it's for 10 weeks. But our school year's for much longer than 10 weeks, so then what happens? Can you speak directly? There's so many teachers who are worried about their health and their safety. They're scared to come to work. We can't have school without teachers. So, Ms. Allison, you.
Sure. And I probably would ask Mr. Craig to help, because I know he is one that would help kind of monitor that policy and help consult, you know, as individuals have some of those needs. But it's the Families First Act. And definitely, if there's anyone who feels at risk, we want to acknowledge and help those individuals. And so they would just need to really, for the first step, is to kind of share and talk with their supervisors so that we can get them connected with some of those resources through the Families First Act. And Mr. Craig's done a really good job, you know, trying to survey staff about some of those concerns, and also sharing some information from the Families First Act with them through the RCS message, and then it's also in our guidebook. So, Mr. Craig, would you mind sharing a little bit more about some of the details around that?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. The Families First Coronavirus Response Act is a federal leave that is actually only 10 days of paid leave. The other days beyond that is deal specifically with COVID-based criteria. Otherwise, the individual would have to use either approved leave that they would normally use if they have it available, or use remote working options if we have those available as well. The Family First Response Act is basically a leave that is only for 10 days, and then they have the ability to go for FMLA. However, again, it will be using their own personal leave that they've earned, not leave that has been given to them as it was prior in the spring semester with the state emergency leave.
Yeah.
And
I also say this too, Ms. McMichael, with some of those teachers, that may be they may be some of the staff that's going to teach the online students that select the virtual learning. So that's another way that they can stay in.
Are the principals appointing the teachers? That's the way I've understood it.
It's going to be a concerted effort, because we're actually trying to get a count on the students. I mean, not students, but the teachers and staff that may be in that medically fragile category, and see where where that alignment comes. And then we're also, you know, once the deadline comes in for the virtual school on the 20th, then that'll give us some idea of the grade level of the students and how many teachers that we would need to teach those classes.
Okay. And I'm assuming the same would be for teachers who are expecting and planning to be on maternity leave. I know we have some people that they need to quarantine.
Yeah, I'll let Mr. Craig answer that.
Thank you for passing it off.
Hey, man, it's like a good quarterback.
We would have to utilize the same process that we would normally utilize for any kind of a medical request, whether it be for emergency leave, because if in a situation similar to that with someone on maternity leave, that would not fall in line with the FFCRA. It basically goes along with their general leave of absence that they would normally fall for or normally qualify for through the process of the medical leave because of maternity leave or what have you. So that's a totally different line as far as what the leave would be based upon. The FFCRA is based on COVID-based requirements, i.e. you either test for COVID, you're quarantined for COVID, or your daycare or what have you has been closed because of COVID.
2 to 10 weeks,
right? Okay. Thank you for answering that. And then the last one I have written down is what about, I know that, and this is, Mr. Craig, this is when, I don't think this is specifically for you, I think this is going to be more to Dr. Shotwell, but what about the expense of Chromebooks for students who cannot afford that to get the Chromebooks from the schools? I know there's like a $30 fee.
Yeah.
And can the, I know we have three different pots of COVID money. Can any of that be used, or do we have the potential to use our Title I money for that?
We actually have a principal fund money that is discretionary funds that are given to the schools each year from the Regional Area Foundation, and oftentimes that is used to pay for the Chromebook insurance for those families that could not afford it. So that's not a barrier for students not to be able to pick up a Chromebook.
Okay, and our principals are aware of that?
Yes, ma'am. We've had that fund now for almost 10 years.
I just had some questions about it.
I think that's great because people need to understand.
Questions in here.
I would hate for a parent to be reluctant about coming to school because they're afraid that they wouldn't have the money to pay for the $30. And if they want to pay and they don't have all the money at one time, you know, they can pay $10, $5, whatever it takes to get to it. You know, we really do work with the parents because we understand the economic issues that they're facing.
Well, people are in such economic distress right now. Parents want to go back to work. You know, it's hard to pay for child care when you can't go to work, but you got to go to work, and kids are at home. It's hard. This is such a mess. I feel like that Plan B, for the governor to put it on us to be Plan B, and that we could pick Plan C. It's just completely. I just feel like it's straddling the fence. It is the best of both worlds because it's not the best for our teachers, and we've got so many teachers who are concerned.
But there are some areas in North Carolina that COVID has not really been a big issue for them because you know, they're really spread out. There's no big towns in the area. And so the possibility of them being able to go back to school, it could work. I can think of several of those schools, and I know Bob can, working up there in Wilkes County, that could do that. So it gives us the flexibility, but I think it's always good to be on the cautious side. And, you know, I think it's really good that you have the staff having the same feelings that you all are about the start of school. Because I think all of us just want to do what's best for our children, first and foremost, and then also provide a safe environment for our teachers and staff. Because, you know, we're all a family, all of us, and we don't want to lose any family members.
So, can I say one more thing?
Go ahead.
Well, I just feel like... I just feel like I have to say that while I understand some people are scared, what about those children that nobody's looking at every day? What about those kids that the only hot meal is the hot meal they get when they're at school for breakfast and for lunch? And that's their safe place. And so to do anything different is just, it's keeping parents home, it's keeping parents from work, putting them in a bind. I don't know. I'm so torn. I'm so torn. Our kids are better off in a classroom. Our adults, our country is not designed to work with people living in bubbles. It's just not, and the tax dollars are going to run out. Our tax dollars are going to run out. We don't have a money tree.
No.
So I know I keep hearing my daddy in the back of my head saying, I don't have a money tree in the backyard. And so, you know, those all of that stuff is generated from our tax dollars and we're not working.
Well, and I also worry about, and the principals and the staff have talked about this too. We are keenly aware that there are going to be some secondary issues when we do come back to school of some mental health issues for all kinds of students. I mean, I have talked to some high school students that when you start asking them about coming back to school, it's an emotional topic because they want to come back. They miss that interaction. They miss that camaraderie of being a part of a team, being part of a band, being part of a play, being in the fire academy, all those different things. People need that unity of being together, and they've lost it. I mean, you know, you think about what happened to our kids. They were going to school just fine Friday the 13th, and that was it. It just ended. There was no goodbye. It just ended. And that's what we're dealing with. And I think that's why we would want the students to come back as much as it is about learning. But that mental health piece. And like I've told you before, we've had over 1,600 calls on our behavioral mental health call-in line since school's been out.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir, Mr. Osley.
Speaking to what Ms. McMichael was talking about, I've got a lot of parents that have reached out to, if we do virtual learning, are we going to have some type of affordable childcare options? Also, if we were to do Plan B in part, you know, where they're going to school part of the week, what about the days that they were home if we were to choose option B? As Kimberly said, there is not a win-win situation for anyone in this case, and not a one-size-fits-all type deal. There was one parent that was mentioning their child does art, and how do you do art from home?
Yeah.
And there's just so, Dr. Shotwell said, fire academy, the hands-on experience, and then the camaraderie with fellow students. And then just the structure of being somewhere on time teaches the children something in life as well.
Mr. Osley, is it okay? I was going to ask you. I have the answers, I think, for the child care piece.
Okay.
You know, we did open up child care. So we have been running our before and after school care at 7 of our sites right now. Dr. Corcoran is speaking with the YMCA organizations because they also work with some of our schools with before and after school care. But what we have in place and what our expectation was that when we would go on Plan B, the days that the students would not be in school, there is an option for child care that we would provide. I mean, it's not free, but it is an option for parents to be able to utilize a space here with our schools for those students to be here with us during those days.
So what you're saying is the sites that currently have school-age child care, they would, like if we did Plan B, then if you went to school on Monday and Tuesday and you were home on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, you could go to school-age child care all day those days at the school.
Yes.
Dr. Shotwell and Madam Chair, may I speak just for a second?
Yes, ma'am, please.
We do have these programs in seven of our county schools. In the city of Eden and the city of Reedsville, they also utilize and work with the YMCA. Now, I cannot speak to what the YMCA will be able to do. We do and are still bound by these issues of social distancing. So while we would be able to provide childcare, and we are looking to do a Monday through Friday childcare, we do have to, you know, consider how many slots we would be able to have. And of course, with all of our schools, all of our, basically our elementary schools that are our seven sites, working to find rooms to, you know, be able to house the students. We're working with our principals, and I've had a couple of conversations just today with some principals to see if we couldn't figure out how to manage, you know, find those places and those schools that would be able to house those students. So we are looking to definitely do that, and that is our goal, but those slots will only be as many as we can find space for as well.
Like, if you think about, like, at the newer schools, the X schools like Huntsville, Monroe, and Williamsburg, and those cafeterias hold 240 kids on a normal time. So then you would have to feel, you know, you would have to think, what would the social distancing look like in there for before and after school care? Because more than likely, we're going to be serving breakfast and lunch in classrooms, at least for, I know, for our elementary school and possibly our middle schools. So that does give you some space there. The other thing that you need to keep in mind, too, because this is one of the things that Dr. Corcoran and I have talked about at length, they're not, the folks that approve licenses for new sites, they're not issuing any new licenses right now. So that makes it interesting as well. So only existing sites right now that we have are the only sites that we can use. Now, and I know the YMCA, whatever their piece is, they have that. But if we were thinking about wanting to expand that to other schools, it would not be something that we'd be able to do in a realistic amount of time.
So, Dr. Shotwell, are you specifically suggested that we can't, are you saying we can't do it in Southampton?
Right. Yes.
That was a good pause. Okay.
Yeah, it was for
say that right, didn't you?
Yeah, well, it was for effect. I mean, just, you know, but they are using Monroe, so if we're on virtual, that does give us a little bit more flexibility those first few weeks to have space there.
Well, so specifically to that, can I know last year when we asked about those kids being at Monroe, there was all this discussion about the concern of Monroe students not having the space that they need because they were going to be sharing it with Southend. They ended up, it really was not an issue at all.
Right.
It sounded, based on the numbers, I don't remember the exact numbers, but it sounded like they could have easily taken 20 to 25 more kids. So can we consider being a little more lenient in that sign-up time? Because we've got to meet those Southend parents. You know, we've got to be able to accommodate them for those things.
You know, I will tell you, our new middle name is flexibility.
Okay.
I'm Shirley.
Yes, ma'am.
And we've surveyed parents to find out how many of them would be. I'm sure this is what you have planned to do. You're not done it. Do you know how many people would even need child care? You know, we need to know the numbers before we can even think about planning.
I need to pass that football off to somebody else that can answer that.
And Dr. Corcoran can speak to this.
We do have a survey. Mm-hmm. We do have a survey, and we are getting ready. Actually, our staff at our schools have already started filling out the RCF staff link. We do have a parent link survey, and we are getting ready to launch. Those have been actually launched when it went live because those surveys are in that presentation. But
We also are going to ask our principals to send those out to their parents. And so that will be in the next, either tonight or starting tomorrow, we'll have, you know, some of those surveys go out. So we do have staff who have already responded, and we're just looking at the numbers, but we're asking that that be completed by a certain time just so we can have an idea about how many people will need child care.
Thank you. I have one other question. I'm showing.
Yes, ma'am.
In the event we do decide to do the remote for 4 or 5 weeks, would it be possible to have students actually sign in? They have to be in place, say, by 9 o'clock, so that teachers can actually take a role, so that they'll know that these kids are in place. I can understand Ms. McMichael's concern also, you know, about those most vulnerable children, those children who may be subject to some type of neglect or abuse. We know this is common, but we also know that this would be the category of children who are also at risk of getting COVID, or who have been exposed to the virus, because that's the population where the virus usually hit the hardest.
Yes,
but
ma'am.
That's two things that I'm concerned about, but the attendance piece I think is very important. We need to start now getting our kids back on the schedule. You know, I mean, if they're like my granddaughter, they stay up and look at movies and then sleep half the day. So, you know, we need to get them on a schedule. You know, we could get them to say, you've got to be sitting somewhere at 9 o'clock every morning. This is your job. You're back in school.
Yeah. Well,
and that will help us. We need to create some kind of organization so that parents will feel good about as well. And I think if we plan to do this, and if parents know that the staff is in the process of trying to provide some options for those parents who do need childcare. We have high school kids, I'm sure, who babysit their siblings.
That's right.
From time to time. And I think they can do that at ages of 12 or 13, legally.
12.
And so in some cases, I'm sure siblings will help out. But if parents know that you guys are working hard to provide some options for them, if they need to go to work, you know, on those days that the kids are, you know, at home, I think that's gonna make them feel better too. And I think our teachers are gonna be relieved also, because we're giving them some options as well.
Yes, ma'am. I was just gonna say, you know, one of the things that we're working through is how are we gonna record attendance and what does that look like? So, I'm going to kick that over to Dr. Perkins.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. We're definitely planning to structure our day as close to a regular schedule as we can, which would include taking attendance in power school, and also some type of possibly, you know, like Google Forms for signing in, if they're on complete online or virtual learning. But attendance is definitely something that's so critical, because as Ms. Bell was saying, the first step in intervening if a student is not participating is knowing that the student is not in class. And once we know that, we can refer those students to the appropriate teams to reach out and make contact and see what's going on, and get them the supports that they need. The Zoom that we have purchased, even if you don't have internet, you can call in to the Zoom meeting and listen to instruction and participate that way as well. So that may even be a way that we can take attendance. We are going to get guidance from DPI regarding attendance. They've sent information this week about the guidance coming, but we definitely know attendance is critical to be able to take.
Madam Chair, could I ask Dr. Perkins or either Dr. Shotwell to make a question?
Please, go ahead.
Do we have, with this new contract with Zoom, do you have the capabilities of just having our kids to actually participate in Zoom? My goodness, that would be awesome if they could.
Oh, yes, ma'am. Yeah. They can participate in Zoom.
Why can't we do that remote when we're doing the remote?
Every teacher will have access to up to 100 participants in their own individual account. And then we are also purchasing 10 accounts that will give 300 to 500, I think we get one free 1,000 access Zoom webinar. So if we needed to get like the whole school together for something, we can do that. But yes, we are definitely planning that Zoom will be a critical component of our instructional plan this year.
Because, you know, even if we did Zoom school for 2 hours a day, I mean, we would have the attention of the kids, and teachers could see the kids. One other thing about the welfare of the children, also Dr. Shaw, their teachers, classroom teachers know their kids. They know whether they eat at night. They know whether they have food on the weekend. If there are children, any of their children that they are particularly concerned about, I would hope that they would contact someone at the central office, you know, Dr. Ellis, Dr. Corcoran, someone, just to have our social officer go out to take a look at them to make sure they're okay. We could easily do that. Teachers know their kids. And maybe that's something that we could get our social workers or psychologists to help us with, you know, to sort of target in on that group of kids.
Yeah.
And Ms. Bell, I can speak some to that. And we have a process for that. And our staff did, we've trained it all year last year, but then when we went into shutdown last year, we pulled them together and did special crisis training. And we call it our Behavioral Health District Integrated Response Team, and our school psychologists, our behavioral health specialists, our school social workers, our school counselors, and our school nurses work with the administrator, and they meet on a regular basis. And they have, we have a way to do social emotional screeners with the students. So that's one way we can identify some students, that might need extra supports. We can take teacher referrals, just like you said, teachers do know their kids. So we can certainly take referrals from there. And then we also do systematic check-ins with the students that we know have some extra social emotional supports. Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me. What does those numbers look like? How many kids are we concerned about?
So March through the end of June, through June, the last school day of June, we had 1,600 contacts with students. So you can tell that's a lot of contacts just in that little bit of time. And so that's what that looks like right now. We did have last year 515 students who had thoughts of hurting themselves or others. And so that's a concern, you know, that we do have a lot of kids who do have thoughts around that. We have those students on safety plans, and we do counseling. And I also want you guys to know we are going to have specialized training that I've set up through our grant, through our mental health grant, specifically in telehealth counseling. So they will be able to provide those counseling services, whether it be face-to-face or whether it be virtually. We want all of our folks to have specialized training. They know how to counsel students, but it is different to do it, you know, through a telehealth platform. And we're going to use Zoom Health, and it would be HIPAA and FERPA protected. So they kind of relaxed some of that last spring, but we know going into this we've had a little more time, so they kind of would expect that HIPAA and FERPA protection. So we would have that too. And so back to the students, though, they keep a regular list of students that we would want to have supplemental services for individualized counseling, and we will plan for regular check-ins. The behavioral health specialist positions that you guys have recommended, we're making good progress on interviewing. And so those individuals will also have students that will be assigned to them for counseling services. And then we have our MOU partners who we'll be meeting with soon to talk about how they can support too. And that's and so several of those are real health agencies in our community that also help us support students as well. And they can serve students virtually as well. So I hope that helped clarify a little bit of that.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And this is literally hot off the press. I got a text saying that the individual teachers' live events are actually bumped from 100 to 300.
Okay. Say that one more time, please.
All the teachers?
Yeah, for all those accounts, correct? All accounts, all the teacher accounts, they have a maximum of 300 now.
Participants.
Participants.
At one time.
At one time.
Wow.
Well,
that's a bump.
So if you're teaching...
So like you could do breakouts and all that kind of good stuff. Breakout groups. And
yeah.
So like an entire second grade could do something.
Do you mind if I share one more thing I forgot to say regarding Ms. Bell's conversation? One of the things too that we had been talking about was if teachers have to work in a virtual environment, which either plan, there would be times they were having to work in a setting, you know, through a Zoom. We have a little SEL check-in, social emotional check-in, that they can do with their students, and their student can kind of select like I'm okay, or I'm sad, or I'm not feeling good today, I'm hungry, I'm tired. And so when they see that, that'll be a quick way for teachers to kind of hone in on that too, and they will be able to, you know, make referrals and talk with that behavioral health team at their school. And or they can, you know, call me, call them, all of us work together, and we can make sure to get those needed supports also.
And that information will be private, just between the student and the teacher.
Yes.
That's right. That's right.
Mm-hmm. And
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I've had a lot of folks that have come online, and we are getting a lot of messages while we're online as well. And folks are saying, well, there's not a lot of information. I just want to let everybody know that if you're online, go to the school's webpage, go to the school's social media Facebook page. I even went on my personal page and posted the document that Ms. Ellis produced. The information's out there. You got to go get it. Everybody's bombarding the school with a lot of requests, but it is out there, and a lot of folks are asking about masks. Since I read it, and I have a lot of people ask me about this on page 27. If you have questions about the exceptions to masks,
I appreciate that, Mr. Osley.
The team also, and I apologize, Dr. Shotwell. This is ever changing. Every day, so it's just like you got information a minute ago going from 150 to 300. So we're having to process it as we're coming in, all of us. So bear with the school.
That's right, Mr. Osley. Thank you for saying that. And we do have some new information up on our website today, too. We have our timeline of all the things we've done. Our reentry team, you can see, started in April. It kind of starts from the time of shutdown all the way to, you know, present time. And so you can sort of see that along with an infographic that's sort of like a one-stop shop of what, if Plan B is the option. We can also make one for Plan C if that's the choice too. And so we can make these, you know, as much as we need to. But, you know, that way people can look at it one time. And then there's also right here our Safe Return to Learn plan. If there's the link to go to a Google site, or there's the link to go to the guidebook. And then we have also begun updating our frequently asked questions, and they are here. And Dr. Perkins and his team have been working really hard on the virtual learning questions. That link is right here at the top. All of those questions are grouped together. And so I'll click on that so you can see it here just for a minute. And it's listed there. So there's lots of things there for folks to read about. And then also we've started our FAQs here from the survey. And so we're making progress through those, but it is taking, you know, some time. But we are committed, and we want everybody to have as much information as possible. And to Mr. Isley's point, I think, you know, that the information is changing so much. You know, there were 185 updates to the CDC page just in June, and just from the day we presented on July 13th to you guys, the next day the governor came out and there was more changes, right? And then there was a plan that was given to us from the Department of Health and Human Services as well as the Department of Public Instruction. That plan, the DPI one came out on June the 11th, and it's changed three times since then. And so has the DHHS, the Department of Human Health and Services one, DHHS one, has changed that many times as well. So so that's just something to keep in mind, you know, that this is a fluid process too, and we will have updates, and we will adjust and, you know, do our best to process what all that means for everyone.
Madam Chair. Sorry, Kendall.
You go ahead. You go first.
Okay, thank you. Also, another question, and I'm just, this has been one that's been reoccurring. If we did choose a B option, social distancing on buses, our buses have a capacity of 72, 24 seats, if I'm not mistaken. But Ms. Ellis, did they, I know originally they said only 10 or 12 students per bus. Are we at 10 or 12, or are we at 24? Did they come back and give us a solid number?
They did. They came back and they have approved, the Department of Health and Human Services on June 24th approved that we could do one per seat. And so that would allow us to do around 24 students. If a child has a medical exemption, then we would need to do the total social distancing. So if they couldn't wear a face covering because of a medical exemption, then we would need to have 6 feet of space around that particular student, just for everyone's safety, the student and the other student. But if they can wear a face covering and engage in the safety protocols getting on the bus, then they can have one per seat.
And if there's siblings, they can sit together on the same seat.
Right.
That's right.
Sorry about that, Ms. McMichael.
Oh, that's okay. I'm just right now, I'm sure y'all can see me. I've got my APN's falling apart. I've got all kinds of issues going on. So, but with that specific question, if you don't mind, Doug, I'm going to start with what you were just asking about. So if we can put 24 kids on a bus, that might not, maybe I'm not thinking about this correctly, but how is that the number of students on a bus going to affect the time that teachers have to be ready to accept children into their classrooms? I know the elementary school that's right now, those teachers have to be in the, they have to be ready with a smile on their face to accept students at 7 o'clock. And so I think that's the earliest in the school system. I think that's the earliest time because of a tiered bus system. So is that going to affect our teachers?
Well, I
will definitely like to defer to Mr. Hensley to talk a little bit about his estimation of time so far. They've been working really hard in the transportation department, and our principals and have been working really hard to get a lot of information for the transportation department to build the route. And so we're in the process of that. So Mr. Hensley, do you think you could speak to that?
Yes, I can address that. A couple of things we are starting to get from all the schools, if the kid's going to be on an A day or a B day, a Monday, Tuesday, or the Thursday, Friday. And, excuse me for the acoustics here. As we're getting those, we're going to start making our routes. But we cannot make those until we have every kid put on an A or a B day. And then that's going to give us more idea of how many routes we're going to need. Our plan is to still continue to tier with the high school and middle school at this point. I think with our kids going half capacity, if we choose that plan, it's going to work out. There might be some hiccups to where you may have an extra route depending on locations and geographic locations, but those things cannot be determined until we get every kid that needs transportation on the school bus. We did do Dillard's when we thought Dillard was going to go back, and we were able to make that work with all their buses and putting half the kids on buses Monday and Tuesday. We did not go over 25 in those.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
The other questions.
Okay.
Go ahead, Bob. Sorry.
I just wondered, once you get the information and feed it into TIMS, how long does it take to get routes out?
Well, routes will be, we've got 124, 25 buses. So as we get them, it's a labor intensive process, and it's going to take several weeks to generate those routes. Now, as we get those routes, we're going to notify schools, but we won't put them all in and just give them to schools at one time, because that's just not feasible. They're working diligently now, and as they're getting them, they're starting to work on routes. But again, their goal was just to put them in TIMS and put them on A day or a B day.
Okay.
Have you gotten, have we heard from all families, Mr. Hensley? Probably not, yeah.
No,
we didn't hear from a lot of families. But what we're doing, even if we did not hear from them, because we really wanted that, a lot of schools had called the families as well to check in on them. But we're not going to kick a kid off the bus. We're going to keep them on that route right now if they rode last year. So that was one of the things we asked the schools to call all their bus riders and get in touch with them to find out if they needed transportation again. Because a lot of them may want to do virtual. A lot of them may come to school and their parents bring them.
Yeah.
Right. So even with the 50% capacity, we're going to be okay in that sense. But there will be some times where we may have, normally we've got a tiered route. We've got an elementary, and then the bus goes and does a middle and high. I'm not saying that we won't have one that does two elementary and has to do that. It could affect that. I don't think it's going to be as overwhelming as we once thought it was when it was eight kids on the bus.
Yeah.
Okay. If we were to go with Plan C, and I don't know if we can answer this or not, if we were to go to, with Plan C for that 4 to 5 weeks, would we be able to deliver meals? Would we be able to go back to that, or would that, is that not a possibility?
They addressed that today, Kevin Harrison, the state director, and it would not be, we would not be able to use funds, yellow school bus funds, 056 funds, to do that. It doesn't mean it couldn't be done, but it would probably have to come out of some other fund.
We had to pay the state back for the miles. So.
Okay, thank you. Ms. McMichael, did you have another question? Okay, go ahead.
So did the governor say if school systems were going to be held harmless with ADM, in terms of, like, if we have kids who are, did my question make sense?
Yeah,
say
it did. Yeah.
I didn't understand.
Yeah. She's asking, with a funding change because of all of this, are we going to be held harmless for a year? I mean, it's the hopes that we will be held harmless. All the school districts have asked for that just because of the uncertainty of it. But I've not gotten anything 100% official that says that's what's going to happen.
Well, I guess where I'm going with that is if we're not going to be held harmless, and if we're even considering Plan C, I have read and cried and screamed and stomped and said things I shouldn't have said over even, you know, us even having to make a vote on stuff. But if we don't return and if we're remote, what happens to our bus drivers? What happens if we're not held harmless, what happens to our teachers?
Well, okay.
About the ones that want to come back.
Well, that's why it's important that we offer that virtual school option, because, you know, if you look at 1,500 K kids enrolling in that, that's equal to almost 120 school teachers. So if we didn't have that option, you'd be giving the pink slip to about 120 teachers. So, and the other thing too is that, like with our bus drivers, they can have alternative assignments, similar to what we were doing in the spring until the COVID leave was approved and understood for the rest of the school year. So, you know, there is an opportunity for them to possibly be able to use alternative alternative assignments until we get back to moving buses around again. And the other, piece is that, you know, you all are the, we as a district are the most financially solvent group in the state, and we can hit an emergency for a year, maybe two, but then after that, I don't know.
So my last question is, if we were to go either way, if we go plan B, mm-hmm. and I understand a lot of people who send us emails, please not do that. But if we go plan B, do you have like a few checkoffs that would trigger us going to plan C? Or is that just going to be, or would we never do that unless the governor calls?
No. We it could happen, but I wouldn't necessarily say that it would happen to the whole district at one time. It could be a single school. It could be a feeder school pattern, depending on if the infection is hitting families in that whole area. But you know, just like with the flu, if you get to a certain point where, like with the flu, normal flu, if we were at 25 to 35% absenteeism, you know, we would probably look at closing school for a few days. But with this, it's not just a few days.
Yeah.
But and I want to stress this too, because of the attendance, because of the grading that that we're, you know, with the professional development that Dr. Perkins and his group is putting together for teachers on how to work on an online environment, you know, we're wanting teachers to engage with these students on a regular basis. And to give them as close to a scheduled experience every day that we possibly can. But, you know, we're always going to put safety first. I know there's some days, like Mr. Huss referred to, when it's snowing, or they think that in one area of the county it looked good enough for us to go to school, and they get mad and they share their thoughts with all of us. You know, we're still going to err on the side of safety, and we're going to do the same thing with this COVID-19.
Dr. Sherman.
Yes, ma'am.
I had a thought about drivers. I know how difficult it is to even find enough bus drivers to drive our students. And like someone mentioned, we also have to think about them as well as those who work in transportation. I know we have some feeding sites now, but not a lot. So if we were to begin our year remotely, could we not use our bus drivers to drive their same routes for breakfast and again for lunch to deliver meals to those bus stops?
They cannot use the yellow school buses, or if they did, we'd have to reimburse the state on the per mile basis with it.
A waiver? Can we ask for a waiver? No. This is,
well, know, as of today, they have not given us one.
What? I'm sorry.
They have not approved one as of today. Mr. Hensley had a meeting with the state director, and they cannot use yellow school buses to do that. And I will say this, when we were delivering meals, we were delivering breakfast and lunch. Breakfast for the next day and lunch for that day when we went out there. So you only had to make the route one time per day. But there is a possibility that we, you know, we do have activity buses.
But you know, could our district ask for a waiver? I mean, someone has to do it. These are not ordinary council.
Well, they've been really, really lenient, because I'll give an example. Just like with the feeding program, had we started school on the 17th, students wouldn't have to pay for any meals across the district because there's a waiver through August 31st. And there's a push to put a waiver in for the entire school year so that we can ensure that all children are going to get fed that need to be fed.
And that's not just for Title I.
That's not just for Title I, that's for all of them.
I'm trying to think of a way to keep hold on to those bus drivers because we just
yes, ma'am.
Can't afford to lose them.
Yes, Mr. White.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Mr. White.
Okay. I was kind of thinking about how we wrap this thing up. And I was sitting here thinking. And I was trying to figure out a good way to say it. So I came up with this. Okay. Virtual learning has had its problems. I'll leave it at that. And then I will say, Dr. Shotwell, go over what you, your staff, your principals think is the best alternative for us at this point.
Our principals felt very strongly for them to ensure the level of safety for both students and staff that if they could have an additional 5 weeks, so we would go 5 weeks out from August 17th. So it would be into September before we would actually implement Plan B.
Okay. Would it be appropriate if I make the motion at this point that we did that?
It would, Mr. White.
She said that'd be great.
I'm sorry. I mean, I'm not speaking up and my ears aren't open very wide. I'm sorry. Also, with 5 weeks, Mr. White, wouldn't that put Dillard at the end of their 9 weeks?
It would. So Dillard would be in their virtual learning for the whole 9 weeks.
Because that would put us through the
18th. That would take care of Dillard as well, correct?
Yes, sir. I know we have it on the on the agenda that way, but you could probably make it into one motion. And I want to say this too: we're also capable, once school starts up, of opening up some more sites for feeding.
Okay. If you will restate that, I will recommend it.
You or me?
Okay.
I am.
What Mr. White would like to do would be to...
Somebody.
That's right. Would be to delay the opening of traditional schools and put them on Plan C for 5 weeks, and also that the Dillard Academy would spend its first 9 weeks on Plan C.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I second it.
Okay, all those in favor, we'll start with you, Ms. Bell.
Amanda Bell, yes.
Yes.
Mr. Isley? Did we lose him?
No, he's on there.
No, I'm there. I had to hit the button. Sorry, I'm parked on the side of the road and it's rather hot. and there was a car going by.
Do you need us to restate the motion?
Say that one more time. I apologize, y'all. I'm so sorry because there was trucks going by.
Doug, the plan would be to include Dillard School and do a 5 week delay on actual face-to-face.
We would implement Plan C for 5 weeks, Mr. Isley.
So similar to what Mr. Huss was saying earlier. Okay. So if that's Bob's motion, yes, aye to that.
Paula Rakestraw, aye.
Bob White, aye.
Vicki McKinney, aye.
Oh, y'all.
Did she say no?
She said no.
Brent Huss, yes.
Okay. All righty.
And we were going to still allow them to do the contactless workouts for athletics.
Yes.
Are you okay with that?
I don't think that needs to change.
I mean.
Made that motion, yeah. Okay. I think we should stand by that.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then we don't need to do action item, the next action item, which was. Oh, did I not? I'm sorry. I apologize. That motion did pass 5-1. No, 6-1. Excuse me. Didn't do my math. So we do not need to move to action item 8.2 because we've already included that.
Right.
Is somebody needing to speak? I'm sorry.
I don't think so.
Okay. All right. I need a motion to adjourn.
A motion to adjourn.
Amanda Bell made the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, Mr. Isley made the second. All those in favor, please start with Ms. Bell.
Amanda Bell, aye.
Doug Isley, aye.
Paul Rexall, aye. Sorry. Go ahead, Mr. White.
Bob White, aye.
Vicki McKinney, aye.
Kimberly McMichael, aye.
Brent Huss, aye.
Okay. All right. Thank you all for being here.
Thank y'all.